Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman, and with me is Abby Rockefeller. For, I'd say, about 20 years, has crusaded against the way, well, sewage is handled in the United States. That room in your house called the bathroom, which contains a toilet, well, Abby Rockefeller has long felt that that's a pretty environmentally unacceptable way to deal with human waste. How so, Abby?
Well, to use water, first of all, to carry waste seems a terrible use of water. And to put that particular set of materials, which really are not waste, they're only waste because we have put them in water, to put them in water is to destroy their value. Those wastes should be returned to the soil, and we should have technologies that make that possible.
And how so? I mean, how could we make that possible?
Well, the system that I have been working with is a composting toilet system called the Clevis Multrum, and that is one method by which one could do this. The principle is to contain those particular wastes. That means that toilet wastes, urine and feces, and kitchen wastes, toilet food waste from the kitchen, to put them in a composting container and let them decompose and turn into something usable, something that doesn't smell, and reduce in volume on the site. It is a very economical, from all respects, from energy perspective and from money perspective, way of recovering the value, of making the value of those materials available for reuse.
For Why, since use. The day of the Romans, however, have most civilized places, quote, civilized,
yes,
gone into this whole notion of plumbing and what have you? Why don't they go towards composting?
Well, we haven't been, quote, civilized for a very long time, is my sense, and people haven't really had enough practice in dealing with this particular problem. In fact, it's something that we've done almost universally badly ever since we were nomadic peoples, ever since we were widely dispersed, ever since we settled down. We did not figure good ways of dealing with these wastes, both from the point of view of health and from the point of view of the environment. And why didn't we? Well, that's a rough one, but clearly the taboos have been great. And furthermore, there had been for so long no need to return these materials to the soil. It was not our job as nomads to take care of the soil. And if it wasn't our job to take care of the soil, if you could just move, it has very closely related to our systems of agriculture. If you could just move and find another patch of soil that would do you fine and was still fertile, why bother replenishing the soil? Why think about what was passing from the agriculture through you and out, either into the water or into something?
Now in the 1990s, in the 70s, in the 60s, if I recall,
yes,
you had some trouble getting governmental agencies here in the United States to accept Clevis Multrum.
I mean, Multrum.
Indoor plumbing was,
right,
I don't know, kind of like the conventional wisdom was that it was the thing. How are things going today?
Well, it is easier to get people to accept this idea first in public facilities, and that's what we are doing as a company mainly. However, I am working also in developing countries to get this general principle of the relation between human health, the health of the soil, the cleanness of the water, and the particular technologies that we use to manage our excreta. I want people to understand that relation, and we are working in developing countries to do that.
On a small scale, I think people might accept the notion of composting of human waste, but I mean, you look at where you are, Cambridge, Massachusetts. You consider New York.
House.
You have one in your house?
In Cambridge, right.
And the city council in Cambridge doesn't particularly object?
They have not objected. The fact is, the house that I have also has a flush toilet, so that's what made it legal. The regulations for residences have not changed dramatically, and they certainly have to change to accommodate technologies and ideas that will preserve the soil. The soil is as crucial as the water. People forget that it's not just a question of wasting water or polluting water. It's a question of not losing the soil, which is really a foundation of civilization.
Also, it's a question, I think, of enriching the soil.
Well, that's what I mean.
It's so nutty that
we will lose it if we don't enrich it. We must return to it whatever we have. And this is a major thing that we have, human manure, which it should be. It has only pejorative terms because we do only bad things with it.
in an urban environment,
yeah,
the feasibility, perhaps beyond Cambridge, go to downtown Boston, go to New York City, how would it work in those environments?
The issue is the principle of separation of this particular set of materials, of wastes, of so-called wastes, of resources from the water stream, from the general sewage stream. That is perfectly possible in a city environment. One can have either large composting systems with very low flush toilets or anaerobic digestion systems in single buildings with management of those systems. That's not something I'm doing right now, but the principle remains the same. That's the issue. If we allow materials, all of which are valuable, but when mixed, lose their value, to be mixed, they lose their value. If we allow the toxic wastes and the heavy metals to be mixed in with the organic so-called wastes, we lose the value of all of them, and each is valuable. But only industries must return their wastes, their materials, whatever they are, within a closed loop, and residences must do it in a different way. That's the only way we can manage matter so that its usability, the matter usability of each type of matter, remains available.
And is anybody, I mean, in big business or in big government, thinking along these lines in terms of big, or maybe people shouldn't think along these lines in a massive way?
Well, they should think along the in a massive, in the sense of social organization, but not necessarily of massive systems. They don't need to be massive systems. Decentralized systems tend to be smaller systems, but you can still think in a very large way. As far as I am concerned, the recapturing of these materials and the conversion of them to their fertilizer value is the only proper thing to do with them. There is really nothing else right. People think in terms of using it for fuel. That is, from an entropy point of view, excuse me, not a good thing to do.
Abby Rockefeller, who's for years now been trying to kind of convert what's been seen as and has been a real problem to a sort of a kind of gold.
Save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
This is Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman, and there is a big myth that farming need be done with chemicals, that organic farming, natural farming is just kind of an unrealistic dream. Well, Bill Dusing is with the Natural Organic Farmers Association, or is it Farming Association?
Well, we're changing the name to Northeast Organic Farming Association to show support for farmers, because most of our members are gardeners or consumers who are interested in organic food and not specifically organic farmers, although we have a lot of organic farmers in our membership.
Let's talk about the issue of whether it's practical to farm without chemicals, whether it's a garden where you might be hit with Colorado potato beetles, or whether you are a major farmer and you're trying to make a living. Mm-hmm. I mean, is it for real something that can be done?
Yes, it has been practical for at least 40 years. In 1980, the U.S. government, the United States Department of Agriculture, said that it worked, organic agriculture worked, that it was economically successful on many different sizes of farms, that it addressed many of the most serious environmental problems of agriculture, but then 12 years of Reagan-Bush pushed that all interest to the side. But farmers in NOFA have been growing organically in New England and New York and New Jersey for 20 years, and it does work. And it's getting easier now because there are lots of new information and research aimed in that direction, so that even the land-grant colleges and the experiment stations are finding out things like, for example, that if you mulch your potatoes with straw, you have less potato beetles.
The chemical companies, they make the claim that, better living, better gardening, better farming with chemistry. I mean, you can't do it without the chemical poisons. I mean, some of the chemical poisons do things that can't be substituted for in terms of organic farming, or not?
There probably is a substitution for almost everything, but we have to look at the whole system. We've been answering the question, how do we grow more food, for 40 years. And the problem in agriculture now is, in most commodities, there's too much food, and they have to find some way to sell it, or else we have to subsidize the farmers that grow it, because there's so much that the price doesn't support the farmers. And so we got to stop answering the question, how do we grow more food, and start asking the question, how do we grow food in a way that creates an environment we can live with and provides nutritious, fresh food to everyone who needs it?
Consumer resistance. One of the problems with organic food is sometimes the apple has a little bit of a blemish, or that is this a problem?
It probably is a problem. If you grow your own food, which I suggest is the best solution, is all of us should grow something that we eat in our school, at your community garden, in your backyard, your front yard, wherever. We should all be involved in that, because then we know the essential reality of life on Earth, which is the sun collected by green plants, which saves the energy that we need in order to keep living.
There were some studies by Barry Common. This is back in the 1970s. He looked at big spreads in the Midwest and analyzed how much was produced in a chemical farm situation and the economics of all that, and how much was produced in an organic farm situation and the economics of that. And he found that the difference was about 15% in yield, but though the organic farmer didn't have as much yield, he was able to save, or she was able to save, because she or he didn't have to buy all these pesticides and the synthetic fertilizers and so forth. Is that study still valid, those studies to this day?
I think it is, and it's even more so now, because the environmental cost and the cost of these pesticides are going up, and especially with the energy taxes may also increase the cost of fertilizers and pesticides, which are all very energy dependent, and it's our subsidies of that energy which create that demand for fertilizer because it's so cheap. But one of the things we know for finding out is the importance of localizing the food system. Because if we look at the green plants collect the solar energy and our mouths use that solar energy, the least distance there is between the plant and our mouth, the more energy efficient our food system is going to be. And it's ridiculous to think we can have a food system that makes sense for the Earth if we're getting our food from Chile and California here in New England.
Now, herbicides are a whole separate subject. Those are these chemicals that kill weeds, and the claim of the chemical industry, the claim of those in big chemical farming, is that to pick weeds, I mean, it takes a lot of people to pick weeds. Is there a substitute there in terms of herbicides?
Well, our labor situation is awful in agriculture in terms of the treatment of the migrant laborers who work there. But we have a system where it doesn't employ people for the most part, in our agriculture, and we have a lot of people in the cities who don't have any employment, and we need to connect those. But herbicides, we find out, create weeds that are resistant to herbicides and increase the weed problems. Whereas when you change to organic, their whole natures of the system, which make weeds much less of a problem, so you spend less time picking them.
Probably the most important thing, I think, about food production is the nutrition of the food that's grown. There are those who say that there's not much of a difference between natural food, organic food, and foods that are prepared and processed and preserved and what have you with chemicals. What's your feeling?
Well, there has been some research that shows that food grown organically does have different nutritional balances, higher vitamin levels, certainly has more flavor because of the nature of good, well-cared-for organic soil. But we also look at the distance between, again, the green plants collecting solar energy in our mouths, and the greater that distance, the less taste and flavor there's going to be in our food. If you buy non-organic, the apple may look good, but it's probably got four different kinds of fungicides on it to keep it good while it travels from Washington State to New England. Whereas the local apple, you can get them, it may or may not have a blemish. If it's not got a blemish on it, you may use it for cider and you drink local apple cider. But the unblemished apples, if they don't travel so far, they have less likely to be blemished.
Big stores, for a while there was a bit of an opening and some of the big chains were selling organic food. Is that opening closing or is it opening more?
I think it's sort of just staying there. The big stores are as an important part of the food system as chemical agriculture. They depend on this long-distance food system, which is very energy intensive. They also take a lot of markup so that the farmer gets less money. Organic farmers are finding much more success with things like community support agriculture, where people directly relate to the farmer, take a share of his produce and pay for a share of his labor and take on some of the inherent risk in dealing with the weather and the soil and the yearly experience of growing crops. But direct farmer-to-consumer relationships and also school gardens, community educational farms, these are the things which are growing greatly. They have to be organic because they deal with children and they have so many positive externalities in terms of benefits to the community, educational experiences, fresh air experiences, and connections to the way our environment works.
Organic farming, and if it can happen in your state, Bill, in Connecticut, I think it can be done anywhere. Back with Enviro Close-Up right after this.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe, trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
Chief, you are lucky.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste, the problem is bigger than you think.
Don't worry, the safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
Hope alone can't save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future. It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. the end of the age of the automobile.
The threat at home, confronting the toxic legacy of the U.S. military. It's a book by Seth Shulman. And Seth argues that the U.S. military is America's biggest polluter. That's amid a lot of competition.
That's
been
true.
Going on a long time, Seth, huh?
It's true. Well, yeah, you have to remember that we're talking about a vast industrial enterprise, thousands of bases around the country, and an enterprise that all told is still putting out nearly a ton of toxic waste every minute. It's a sum that is far greater than the largest multinational, and some people say it's larger than the top five combined.
They don't care? I mean, the military is just oblivious to environmental protection?
Well, it's a complicated story, and one that I tracked for about 5 years trying to put the book together. And basically what it boils down to is that the military is tremendously insulated, and for all these Cold War years has hidden behind a veil of national security. And while in 1978, President Carter signed an executive order that said that all federal facilities should be treated like everybody else, during the Reagan years, it was simply ignored. And we find that the U.S. government, the U.S. military, has been probably the most flagrant violator of its own laws.
Now we're into the Clinton years. The indications are there's been no massive change?
There has been a massive change. Concerns about the environment have definitely filtered into the military. Unfortunately, we have some four decades of toxic legacy left to us. If you count the environmental problems from the nuclear production facilities, we're talking about a cleanup that's going to run well into the hundreds of billions of dollars over the next decades as we try and clean it up. The thing that's changed is that there's a growing appreciation of the problem in the military. When I first started on the book, it was very difficult to find anybody in a position of authority who could speak to the issue. That's changed. The cleanup, we're still very, very much at the beginning of the something on the order of 17,000 toxic sites that the military acknowledges
17,000?
Now.
17,000?
17,000. We have actually cleaned up something on the order of 2%. So we have a long, long way to go.
You're talking about 98%. You're talking about 16,000, 600, 700 sites still to go.
That's right. I mean, we have been in a study phase. The military every year has put out a report about how bad the problem is, and basically what we've seen over the past 4 years or so is that every year the number of sites virtually doubles. As they discover more and sort of acknowledge the severity of the problem. I think the good news is that we're leveling off. Some of these 17,000 sites, these are sites currently or formerly owned by the military, so this is some land that might have been used in the past, some current bases. Out of these, some are relatively benign and they're going to drop off fast. As I said, the good news is I don't think it's going to go dramatically higher. We're not going to see it doubling again as we have. The bad news, of course, is that virtually none have really been cleaned up. Of this 2% that I'm talking about, a lot of it is simply moving barrels from one place to another. We haven't really begun the full cleanup yet.
And we're talking about nuclear toxics. We're talking about stuff that will be around for some of them tens of thousands, perhaps even millions of years?
My book focuses primarily on the conventional run-of-the-mill toxics that come from solvents, from maintaining fleets of planes and tanks, but certainly the portion from the nuclear production facilities is tremendous, and it's a special case. It's going to be some of the hardest to clean up.
Is part of the dynamic here that the military is somewhat immune from legislation which would regulate a corporation?
Well, historically, yes. It's been a big fight between the regulatory agencies, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, and the Department of Defense. The good news here is that a lot of things are changing as of very recently. The last Congress finally passed a law called the Federal Facilities Compliance Act, which puts teeth into the executive order that President Carter signed in '78 that I talked about a minute ago, What this does is it allows states and other people who have been essentially victims of the pollution, nearby communities, to take action. And it means that the military can face the same kind of penalties that and fines that that the private sector is liable to also.
To bring this down to the human course, or up to the human course, you relate in your book some of the stories, the tragic stories. Can you give us a couple of examples of the impact of all this?
Sure. I mean, my book is absolutely made for the general public. It's not a technical book about the problem. And you know, very quickly, let me tell you the story of the Cornhusker Army Ammunition Plant in Grand Island, Nebraska. There are dozens of ammunition plants like this. This produced bombs up through the Vietnam War. And at this plant, the explosive compounds that they used to pack into the bombs were basically dropped into the ground and got into the groundwater. And the Army knew it for years and years. The evidence I found shows that they basically knew they had a contamination problem back to 1970. They even tested people's wells. They knew that the contaminants were migrating and that the people right adjacent to the plant drunk from groundwater wells and used them for agriculture. And even though they knew that they had a serious contamination problem, they didn't notify the public for a full year after the evidence was very strong to indicate that that those people were at risk. One of many, many examples. I start the book with the Jefferson Proving Ground. It's a 100-square-mile facility in the southeast corner of Indiana. For 40 years, we tested artillery shells, bombs, mines here. And the Army says now that we have anywhere between 1.5 and 7.5 million unexploded pieces of ordnance there. It's a 100-square-mile minefield. This is like a minefield the size of Manhattan and Washington, D.C. put together. This is one of the bases that's slated for closure now. We're seeing a lot of bases start to close up. They have no idea how to clean this up. If they were to do it, they'd have to strip mine the entire facility down to a level of some 20 feet. Almost impossible task. It would be a billion-dollar task, so they're not going to do it. It's going to be fenced off, and it will just be left there for the neighboring community to live with.
This has been Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.